All right, good morning, Calvary Church. It is great to see you. We had some technical difficulties there, but we are started and ready to go. So tell a friend and excited to worship God with you here. I know today we are online and outdoors, so hello to everybody outside. Thanks for your patience. Thanks for joining us here on campus today. I know that our world is constantly changing and constantly issues, but I want you to know that we worship a God who never changes, a God who stays the same and is strong, and he can be relied upon no matter what. And so I want to encourage you, if you feel afraid in this time or you feel frustrated about this season that we're in, to place your trust, to fix your eyes, to place your hope and your faith in Christ alone. I want to read to you from Psalm 145 about our great and mighty God. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They celebrate your abundant goodness and joyfully sing of your righteousness. We worship a strong and mighty God. If you're here at home, let's stand and sing to him now.
Jesus, you're the King of my heart, be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from, oh, he is my song. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life, oh, he is my song. You are good, you're good, oh, Lord, you are good, you're good, oh, you are good. Good. Oh, Lord, you are good, you're good, oh, let the King of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in the waves, oh, he's my song. Let the King of my heart be the fire.
My shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. God, thank you so much that this is how we fight our battles. No matter what season of life we're in, how scared or how anxious we feel, God, in your name is how we fight our battles. God, we can do nothing without you. And thank you so much that you're here so we can fight. Thank you, God, for knowing our limits and knowing how much we can take and only giving us that. We may feel overwhelmed. We may feel so stressed and frustrated. But God, you are here with us. Thank you so much. And I pray for the message that we will have open ears to what you have to say to us, God, and that you will speak to us. And God, please touch the hearts of one person today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Hey, well, good morning, Calvary Church. It's good to be with you once again. If you are new this morning, we would love to turn you to the card right now, a place you can just fill out some information, we can learn more about you, and you can kind of select a few options of maybe some ministries that you're interested in here at Calvary. Additionally, if you're not new, you could also fill out the card, and if you find yourself in need in this season, you can write down those needs or ways that we can help support you in this season as well. And if you're sitting there and you're like, I would love to offer help, I would love to offer my time and my resources, you could also take the card and fill out areas where you would like to serve and help out. So that is the card. It is there for you. And this season, we've been doing something really cool over the past, 9 months, I guess, however long COVID's been. It's called the Pop-Up Food Pantry. It's been such a cool time. It was weekly, but now it's monthly, a cool time serving our community. So go ahead and check out this video of what it's been like. A cool time serving our community.
This is my absolute favorite day. It's always just a miracle who's going to show up and help us out here, and God is always just so faithful. You know, it says love your neighbor as yourself, and you guys are out here loving our neighbors like more than yourselves, because you're putting yourself out there with these hazardous conditions, and I'm touched and blessed and just so thankful that you're here to help out.
We're at the food pantry, serving the community, passing out ice cream, passing out food, directing traffic,
shopping with the carts, loading heavy boxes. That's why we don't go to the gym, because the gym's closed. That's why we come here.
All right, you guys ready?
Hey, my name is Lambert, part of the team at Vineyard Anaheim. We are just so grateful for actually Calvary Church, this space here. Thank you, Calvary, your amazing volunteers, for opening up this space. Since we've been doing this in March, We are on pace at the end of the year to hit 5.5 million meals. That's because of your great partnership, your great work. We can't tell you enough how valuable food is in this moment. Food is not the most important thing, but it affects everything that is important.
Have a good night. God bless.
So this is not just handing out boxes. We are not a food distributor. We are a hope distributor. That's our hope today, is that all these cars come, and that they get food, but they get much more than that. They get hope.
Awesome. So that is a little sneak peek behind the scenes view of what the pop-up pantry has been like these past few months. And in fact, we could always use volunteers. And this Tuesday, we have another pop-up pantry. So if you're sitting there sipping your coffee thinking, I would love to serve at the pop-up pantry All you got to do is show up here at Calvary at 4 o'clock on Tuesday and get ready to pass out food to those in need. And if you are finding yourself one who needs the food, we encourage you to come through the drive-thru as well and receive what you need. And the pop-up food pantry relies also on your generous giving. We need to actually fund the food, buy the food that we could pass out. And so a way you can give to support financially is through our ENF fund. So I encourage you to do that if you are able and willing today. And in fact, this whole concept of giving and worship through giving, we can give at Calvary to our ENF fund, which is our emergency needs fund. We can give to our reach fund and then our general fund. And as we consider worship through giving, I just think about how we were just reminded a few minutes ago that God is our shepherd and we have all that we need. And he calls us to give generously as he's given to us so generously. And this is an opportunity to give back and say, God, thank you. And sometimes it's hard to trust. It's hard to give of our finances. And I want to turn us to Proverbs 3, where it says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Lean not on your own understanding, and all of your ways acknowledge him, and he'll make your path straight. It's just a little principle that we can say, yes, I can trust God with all my heart and not lean on my understanding of how he'll provide. So I encourage you to give in those ways today prayerfully as an act of worship. So we're going to jump into our message. So go ahead and pray with me this morning as we give and as we hear from God's word. God, you are so faithful to us. God, you are so generous. God, you love us despite us and our sin. God, we thank you for the ways that you've worked in our hearts in this season. God, I pray that we lead into you, that God, we would trust you, that God, as we consider what to give, Lord, we would do so obediently, trusting God that you're a good God and you will provide for all our needs in Christ Jesus. Lord, I pray for the message this morning as Dave comes up and opens your word and shares. God, I pray we be moved by your word, Lord. I pray that our hearts would be open to receiving, God. And that, God, this whole concept of faith, Lord, would be one that renews our strength this morning. So, God, we love you and we ask all this in your name. Amen.
Good morning, Calvary Church. Good to see you. Thanks for joining in. And I'm going to edit a little extra that I wasn't going to say, but I want to thank all of our tech people. I know it's been a rough morning, so we're thankful for our staff, for our volunteers who help make these things possible. So we're grateful for that. It's been a crazy year, and it's just fitting that here we go again with some bumps in the road that we didn't expect, but people working hard to make the best of the situation. So we're glad that you're here. We're glad that we're able to communicate to you in this way. We know life has been difficult for a lot of folks. You know, this COVID thing is crazy. Just to be open with you, I was working on an outside project from Calvary Church and with another coworker, and the individual that we were working with turns out was COVID positive. And before we left each other, he says, "I'm a hugger." And so we hugged. And so he's having symptoms of COVID and he has positive test results of COVID. And here I am wonderfully getting a beautiful hug from him. I didn't know I was that huggable, actually. And so I've been in quarantine. I'm actually in quarantine now. There's nobody in this room. Everybody's keeping 600 feet from me. And I think Governor Newsom is actually going to pass a law that when people like me come into a room, we have to yell out unclean. And so it's just kind of a new world that we're living in with all these new features, disruptions. It's just annoying for me. My coworker actually came down with the COVID and is recovering from that as well. So it's some challenging times. And that's why this passage is important to us today. We're going to be looking at Hebrews chapter 11. As we've been going through the book of Hebrews, we're seeing that these are a group of people that should have been growing in their faith. They're wandering in their faith. They're not solid in their faith. And then the author of Hebrews challenges them in their maybe lack of faith or their wavering faith to help them to be able to grow and to be more productive. And this passage is really all about Moses and how I see God helping Moses to grow in his own personal faith, because like all of us, he had his weak points, but God was going to bless him and make it possible for him to grow. Let me read the passage. I encourage you to have Bibles in hand as well. Hebrews 11, verse 23. It picks up on a number of people in the Old Testament times, and here we come to Moses. It says, by faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months by his parents because they saw he was a beautiful child, and they were not afraid of the king's edict. They were in Egypt, and Pharaoh was the dictator at that time, a tyrant ruling over them. And by faith, Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, because Pharaoh's daughter had plucked him out of the little water that he was floating in, that his mother had placed him in, and choosing rather to endure ill treatment with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. Considering the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. By faith, he left Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king or Pharaoh, for he endured as seeing him who was unseen. By faith, he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of the blood, so that if he was destroyed, the firstborn would not touch them. By faith, they passed through the Red Sea, as though they were passing through dry land, and the Egyptians, when they attempted it, were drowned. Then they enter the promised land without Moses, but the people did, led by Joshua. It says, by faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they had encircled for 7 days. By faith, Rahab, the harlot, did not perish along with those who were disobedient after she had welcomed the spies in peace. And so the author here is assuming we have a lot of knowledge about that time, and I want to fill in some of the blanks on that as we go through it. But I want to highlight what I love about this. A great theologian once said this: clarity about God's work in our future is better understood by learning from his work in the past. So Hebrews 11 is sort of that attempt to help us to learn from how God worked in the past so that our clarity about what God wants to do in your life and my life, we can have better understanding about that moving forward. And in Moses' life, what I see is a progression of faith. And I want to lay out sort of the tracks of that journey that Moses was in, because I think it's important for us to follow that, to be part of that kind of a lifestyle. No matter where we begin, we can jump into that journey that Moses was on. And the journey that Moses began when he was 3 months old, it's a faith that is founded on a family of faith. And I think a lot of us already know this, that how important it is that we build into our children, those of us who are blessed with children, a foundation of faith. The verse says this: by faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months by his parents because they saw he was a beautiful child and they were not afraid of the king's edict. Here's a family of faith that says we're not being dictated to by how man rules over us, because we know we have our eyes on someone who is higher than that. God is in control. God is sovereign. God is going to provide for our baby. We're going to put him in the bulrushes as we sing that song, and we're going to trust that God is going to rule over his life as well. And he did from the very beginning. But I love that image of a family that says we're a family of faith trusting in the Lord. And I love that also that little phrase, because they saw that he was a beautiful child. Well, who doesn't have a baby and think that their own baby is a beautiful child? And I thought long and hard, where can I get a picture of a beautiful baby that maybe can help portray sort of the age of Moses in those early months of his life, so that we can kind of have a mental picture of a beautiful child? I thought long and hard and just randomly came up with this picture here. This is actually, as it turns out, is my granddaughter, Camille. And here she is, about 4 or 5 months of age. And I think that she is a beautiful child. I'm sorry. Don't you just want to pause for a moment and you just want to just hug her? She is a beautiful. This is the baby Moses. And this is how those parents felt about a little baby like this. It's just so precious. And so I'm going to build on that for a moment. But look, notice as the progression of the passage goes on. It's a faith that is a foundation of the family. And we need to lay those tracks for our children. And let me just add this, that not all of us grew up in families of faith. Not all of us have that foundation. And my heart goes out, my prayers would go out to those that I know that have not had that fortune as well. But let me also add that if you didn't grow up on a foundation of faith, maybe today is the day to say, Lord, I'm going to start building that foundation. Whether you're single, whether you're married, whether you're a grandparent, that you're going to begin to build that foundation for your life and for the lives of those around you. Because that's where Moses began. And there's never a time where it's too late to begin that journey of faith. And we'll talk more about that as we move forward. As Moses grew up, he then made a decision. He made a decision to serve Jesus Christ. He didn't call it Christ. It's not mentioned in the passage. But there is this beautiful image of someone who was unseen that is really controlling Moses' life. And he has this heart of faith for the things that he cannot see. The passage says this, by faith, Moses, when he had grown up, he becomes an adult. He needs to personalize that faith and make it his own. It's no longer what his parents gave to him. It's what he chooses to do. So as an adult, he made a conscious dedication to follow Jehovah God, Yahweh, as he might have been known in those days. So he says, when he had grown up, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh, even though he grew up in Pharaoh's court, was well educated by Pharaoh's household. So he had many benefits that were really a luxury in that part of the world for a Jewish person. So he grew up in Pharaoh's daughter's house, and then I love this, he chose, choosing rather to endure ill treatment. There comes a time in our lives as an adult where we make this conscious choice to say, Lord, I'm going to serve you. And it may cost me. So he endures ill treatment with the people of God. And that is to enjoy that, and then to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. He's going to follow Yahweh rather than the passing pleasures of sin. Say that two times. Considering the reproach of Christ. Now, Christ wasn't there. But the Hebrew author says, you know, Jesus is in the Old Testament. He is all over the Old Testament. He is someone who is present with them, even if they can't articulate it or see him the way we know him today from the New Testament. But Jesus was there. And Moses had a faith in someone he could not see. He considered the reproach of Christ, the sacrifice, the punishment of Jesus, he considered that a greater rich than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking for the reward. He's looking for beyond. Abraham was the same way, looking for a city that he never really occupied. All of Hebrews 11 is looking for something that we don't even realize here because God says there's something greater for you. And so it just reminds me how important it is that as families, we have a foundation of faith, and as adults, we have a commitment to faith and how that can really, really direct our lives. I remember earlier in my ministry years having a premarital counseling with a couple who were in their 20s, young 20s, professional people. And as we talked about sort of their lives and helping make sure, as best you can, a premarital counseling, to help them become a good married couple, I talked a little bit about, to the wife-to-be, about her family. Tell me about your family of origin. What are those things that you remember? And when I asked her that question, she just broke down in tears. She began to sob. I was kind of taken back. And so as she finally collected herself, she shared, the thing that I remember about my parents is the day when she was probably about three or four, standing in the doorway of their house, watching her father leave their family as her mom and her dad separated and then lost their marriage. I still remember that, she said. And what I saw is there is a wound in her heart. So it creates a foundation that's a little fractured. And this isn't to cast shame or blame, but it's to show the discovery of what Christ loves to do. Because here's a couple that in their 20s said, even with this brokenness of the past, they made a commitment to follow Jesus in their marriage. And this was a wonderful wedding. And the beauty of this is that her mom and her dad reconciled. They repaired their marriage. And they were a flourishing couple, following Jesus Christ, because they made a second half of life decision to say, although we've had a broken foundation in the beginning, we're going to start fresh and new. And they did. So her parents and their marriage and the groom's parents, it was a beautiful wedding of Christian committed couples saying, we're going to follow Jesus. And so they began to lay a new foundation for them. And now the grandchildren have come into this world. And there's a new foundation for them as well. So all that to say that in this early years of Moses, there's brokenness there. Moses, in his first attempt to follow God, goes out and kills someone and thinks he's going to be the great leader, and they reject him. That's not in this passage, but it is in Exodus. And so there are those broken conditions that we will go through. But God is in the business of restoring and healing and making things right when we walk by faith in his grace and his power and his blessing in our lives. We see it countless times over and over. For those that make a decision to choose to say, Lord, I'm going to follow Jesus. There are many pleasures out there of sin, but I'm going to follow Jesus instead. I'm going to build a foundation for my life and those that are in my life so that we can grow in the way you want us to grow. So his foundation was in the family. His decision as an adult was to be committed to Jesus Christ, even though Jesus is not there in Exodus, but Jesus was there in reality. And then we see that's a faith that God loves to mature. I read just this morning someone that said, God is not so much interested in our professing faith as he is in our maturing faith. God is not so much interested in a professing faith as he is in a maturing faith. And what Moses is now to enter into is a maturing faith. God says, you've made a decision to follow me. Is his life going to be full of luxury and pleasure and good palaces in which he's going to live? No, he gave up all of that. This is not a passage for the health, wealth gospel. This is a passage for those who really want to grow before the Lord and have their faith blossom and mature and bear fruit for the kingdom of God. And that's what Moses did. I remember 22 years ago, I planted these trees in our front yard. And I remember 22 years ago when I planted those trees, you know, pastors are always looking for illustrations for messages. And so I planted those trees myself, and they were just little tiny twigs at the time, maybe barely taller than I am. And I remember the gardener that sold me the trees and told me how I should plant it and the fertilizer and all that stuff. He says, make sure you dig a big hole. And then fill it up with all this other healthy stuff that helps the trees to grow. And then put a stake in there. But he says, one thing you should not do. You should not make that stake and those little green things you wrap around the tree and the stake. Don't make it too tight. Leave it a little loose. It'll look a little wobbly. But that's important. Because when that wind blows, and those Santa Ana winds blow, boy, they blow right through our house. That tree's going to wobble. And you're going to think, I should tighten it up. No. Because the more that tree experiences the storm of that wind and wiggles back and forth, the stronger those roots become as they penetrate that rich soil that you put in underneath them. So that when they get as tall as they are here, he would have said, they are stronger than ever because they withstood that storm because you allowed their roots to grow deep and hold on to the earth that is underneath them. And I think that illustration here 22 years later is still appropriate because God allows us to go through these winds that we don't particularly like here in the year 2020, whether they're political winds, whether they're health winds, they're financial winds that are blowing against us and creating this havoc, the social isolation winds of those who are confined to facilities and family cannot see them. These are devastating things. But when our roots of faith are deep in the Lord, he says, I will hold you firm through those experiences. And notice some of the things that this passage tells us about Moses and how his faith matured. Well, number one, he endured by keeping his eyes on Christ, not his enemy, not his circumstances. This passage tells us that. By faith, he left Egypt as they left after the 10 plagues and Pharaoh and all that, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who was unseen. How did he endure? By seeing him. And the NASB capitalizes that word, H-I-M. Who is the him, the antecedent? It is Jesus Christ. It is God the Father. He had his eyes not on Pharaoh. He had his eyes not on the plagues. His eyes not on the people. But he had his eyes on God, that God was going to get him through this. So he endures. So much about the Christian life is enduring. So much in the book of Hebrews is about perseverance and enduring. It's not always about enjoying, but it is a lot of it about enduring. The second thing I noticed that helps to mature his faith is that he obeyed the commands of God. God laid down a command after the 10th plague comes up, and he says, one of the things I want you to do is to create a new religious behavior, and we call it the Passover, as the angel of death will pass over your home if you apply the blood. And when that blood is applied, then death goes by you and you live. Well, that's what Moses obeyed. By faith, he kept the Passover. He had faith that although the angel of death was going to come, he had faith that the blood would keep him alive. And the sprinkling of the blood so that he who destroyed the firstborn would not touch them. And you know, today we live by faith in the blood of Christ. He celebrated that Passover days before his own death so that his blood could be our Passover, the Passover of death over us, so that we could have new life. But we keep those commands. We keep obedience to him. We don't rebel in frustration, but we obey in faith. That God, you told me to do this, so I'm going to do it. It doesn't always make sense. I don't always understand it. But God, I'm going to trust you. So he endures through the sufferings by keeping his eyes on God. He endures through this turbulent time by keeping his obedience to God. And then finally, he believes in God's power when obstacles appeared. So he runs on all the millions of Jews. It might have been 2 million Jewish people that were leaving Egypt at that time, and God had actually given them some of the goods of the Egyptian people to fund this trip. But they go in the wilderness and they wander around. They don't know where they're going. They seem lost. And Pharaoh says, this is my chance to attack them. So Pharaoh comes chasing after them, and they try to get away, and they come to the Red Sea. There's no place for them to go. So by faith, though, God says, you will pass through that Red Sea. I know it's impossible, but Moses, he holds it up, the seas part, and they go through on dry land, as though they were passing through dry land, and the Egyptians, when they attempted it, were drowned. And Exodus 14 is a beautiful portrait of that. Let me just dip into that passage for a moment to show some of the ways that God does this work today even. So we see in Exodus chapter 14, we don't have time to look into it. I encourage you to read through the passage. It's incredible how God honors the faith of Moses to get them through this place. Well, there's three ways that God tested them at that time, parallels to what Hebrews 11 says. And the first, in more of a practical application, is that sometimes God allows what I would call difficult people. Pharaoh is much more than that. But difficult people come into our lives that make life very disruptive, that hold us back, that control our freedom, to be able to practice our faith. There are things that people are doing even today that controls our behavior, and it frustrates us. But more than that, there are people that are difficult sometimes that we think we can count on. What's interesting, I didn't put it on the slide, but not only Pharaoh, but it was the Jewish people themselves who said, Moses, we want to fire you. We're not happy with how you're leading us. They said, we want to go back to Egypt. We want to return to the sort of the making of bricks in this drudgery of life under the control of Pharaoh. And sometimes it's the people that you think you can count on the most that undermine you the most. And that's painful. So sometimes God allows the difficult people that really frustrate our lives. Sometimes God allows impossible circumstances like the Red Sea. Well, there seems like there is no way out of this, and there's a barrier between where I am and where I want to go. I remember early on when I was first here, many years ago. I feel like I'm talking like an old person now. But I remember years ago, I was sitting down with our controller, the man who was running sort of the finances and the financial facilities of our church family. And he told me, Bill told me, Dave, now here's the deal. We've got all these bonds that have to be paid for because we had financed this building. And so we're going to pay those bonds first. And if we have any money left over, then we'll give you a paycheck. And so if there's no money left over, you're just going to have to suck it up. He didn't say that, but that's kind of the implication. I said, oh, well, that's fascinating. Here I am like 1 month into the job and didn't know about that. And so there are these circumstances that come along. And so you pray, God, help us. You know, I've got a family to support. You know, do I need to go work at, Home Depot? What's going to happen? And so it's interesting that as we prayed about that in the course of that year, someone came forward and said, you know what? I hear you have some bonds that need to be paid off. Well, yes, we do. Well, I'm going to write a check to cover the payment for all the remaining bonds. And it was somewhere between $500,000, $600,000. So I sat there. I'd never seen someone write a check for that amount of money. I didn't know if there'd be enough room for all those digits. But somehow it fit. And I'm thankful for it. And I'm thankful for that family that made that possible. And suddenly we were freed up. We were not paying $500,000 for this building anymore. But now that ministry, that money could go into ministry. That we then had this sort of this plan of, if we had another $500,000, where would we invest that? It's not like we're a bank where we're going to store it away. We want to invest it in ministry. And we began to think and dream of what God would do. But I think about that. When God has impossible circumstances, God loves to keep us back, the barrier, the water, and then say, God, I've got no place to go but you. And God provides. And then there's discouraged hearts. The people, if you read Exodus chapter 14, you will see that they were crying out and they were living in fear. And a lot of us live in fear these days, fear of COVID. We can't be with our family. We're supposed to only be with our family on Thanksgiving Day for 2 hours. You know, these things that constantly sort of create anxiety and fear about the conditions of our world. And these are small things in comparison to a lot of what Moses and the ending chapter of Hebrews 11 experienced. But there are things that cause us fear. And so these are the conditions that we go through of difficult people and impossible circumstances and really discouraged hearts. And God knows that. So he brought these people to that point so that he could help them mature in their faith. And it doesn't always seem like it's a maturing thing. It feels almost like sort of a mean thing. But out of that comes this blossom of great faith. And now we're reading about Moses today because he was the one who expressed the faith in those times. He didn't quit. He didn't bail. There were times when he was really frustrated with God. There was people who wanted him to fail. They wanted him to be fired, the Jewish people that followed him. It was not an easy time in which Moses lived. But here we are, thousands of years later. We're talking about Moses, not about failures, but about his faith. Because God honors those who live by faith, to look to the one who is unseen, to look beyond the circumstances, to see a God who cares, and he'll get us through it. So I love what God told Moses to tell the people in this closing verse in Exodus 14, 13. As the people are whining and complaining, we need to be careful whether the political things, the election, the COVID, and the rules, and Governor Newsom, and all these things that can be so frustrating, you just want to complain. I don't want to be one of them that were there in Exodus 14, just griping and complaining. I want to be one that understands what Moses says here. But Moses said to the people, do not fear. Stand by and see the salvation of the Lord. And he will accomplish for you, which he will accomplish for you. And he did. And the beauty of Moses' faith is that he doesn't always see it immediately. Moses didn't get to go into the promised land because he still had another momentary lapse. But God is so gracious that here we are honoring Moses with that wonderful faith. And he stood by. He did not fear. And they saw the salvation of the Lord. And you and I, we can live that same way as well. And the last portion of this Hebrews 11 is this. Without going into it, they went into the promised land. Rahab the harlot, that's very unfortunate that she's always kind of Rahab the harlot. That's not her last name. But unfortunately, that's the way we often will see her positioned. And yet she was a woman of great faith. And she is now in the line of the genealogy of Jesus Christ. God honors these people of faith. And so therefore, our faith will be rewarded with, in our day, a promised land. And that is the heavenly kingdom. Our eyes and our vision and our faith rest not in the temporal things of this world or the people of this world or the rulers of this world. Our faith, like Moses' faith, it rests in somebody greater, Jesus Christ, God's power, God's strength, that God gets us through this. And we do not fear, and we stand by, and we see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for us. Last week, I saw a wonderful video that maybe helps illustrate this in more vivid ways of the tragedies that God will bring us through, but we keep our eyes on Jesus Christ. And the story of Greg Laurie, as he reflects about the loss of his own son.
12 years ago, I heard the news that no father ever wants to hear. I was told that my son had died in an automobile accident. I was never able to say goodbye to him. This is a photograph of Christopher in Israel, and that's his little daughter, Stella. And we were praying, and look at her little hands folded. It's so sweet. But when you hear news like this, I can't even describe to you what it feels like. You know, it's interesting. We have names for people who've lost loved ones. For instance, if you're a wife who loses your husband, you're a widow. If you're a husband who loses a wife, you're a widower. If you're a child who loses your parents, you're an orphan. What are you if you're a parent who loses a child? It's interesting, there's no expression or description. Maybe because it's basically unthinkable. We all know that our grandparents will pass into eternity before us. We know that our parents will. We might even think about how our spouse might precede us to heaven, but we never think about our children. I was not able to see my son afterwards. I was actually told he was unviewable, which was devastating. He died in an automobile accident. I was given a little plastic bag with his belongings. It was his wallet, his wedding ring, his car keys, and a watch. And this watch I gave to him a couple of years before that. And on the back of the watch, I inscribed Jeremiah 29:11. You know what that says, right? God says, I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. Here I am holding this watch, and I was thinking, well, where's the future and the hope? He was only 33 years old. Is the Bible wrong? No, because the ultimate future and hope of the Christian is heaven. You know, we think of that sometimes in the here and now. Well, I hope I get this job, or I hope I meet that girl, or I hope this happens. And we put it all in temporal things. But the ultimate future and hope that God promises is the hope of heaven. Look, you don't ever get over something like this, but you do get through it. And I bring it up time to time so I can bring encouragement to others, because I hear from people who've lost loved ones. In fact, when I post this, there will be a lot of comments, and if you read them, you'll read heartbreaking stories of people who've lost children and lost other loved ones. And I say this because I want to say to them, you're going to get through this if you hang on to Jesus Christ. He's the only one who can get you through a tragedy of this kind. He's done that for me, and I know that he'll do it for you. We all as Christians have that future and hope. Let's hang on to it.
Well, I love that story. I love Greg Laurie and appreciate his heart. I've never been through something that he has been through. But I thought it'd be helpful for all of us to hear a story of real suffering, of real hardship, and yet keeping his eyes on Jesus. That's what I love about that. That's what Moses was doing. He kept his eyes on him who he could not see. And so as you and I go through whatever experiences of life, this week, this Thanksgiving, the holiday season, the coworkers, the classmates, the friends, the neighbors, the family members we gather with, that we would be like Moses, keeping our faith on the one who watches over us, to do not fear, to stand by and watch God accomplish his salvation through us. If you've never believed in Jesus, maybe today's the day you start that journey of faith and begin that foundation of faith and watch that faith prosper and grow as God blesses you through this time. Let me pray for us. Father God, I pray that you would help us as your people and those who have yet to make a decision to become a follower of Jesus, that you would help us to be followers of him, that as we go through the storms that blow through our lives, the chaos of this 2020 year, and the personal struggles that many of us, I know, are experiencing, but that God, that our faith would be deeply rooted in you, that like Moses, we would have our eyes set on you, not on those things that frustrate us, not the Red Sea, not the Pharaoh, not the discouraged people, but our eyes and our faith resting in you, and help us work through those times of testing, that we would see that you're the God that we stand by, and your salvation will be accomplished to us. We thank you for it, as I pray it now in Jesus' name, amen.
Focus on the words. The words are so powerful to this song, and we tend to overlook it because we know it so well. So I encourage you in this moment, as I'm just gonna sing and play Amazing Grace, that you sing with me, even though it's gonna be kind of weird because no one's in the room, but I encourage you just to lift your voice to God because he is a God of amazing grace. And with that, if you, I encourage you also to get into a posture of worship, whether that be standing, sitting, kneeling, opening up your hands, opening up your arms, whatever is comfortable for you, whatever you feel God is leading you. I encourage you to step into that and be bold in that.
God, my Savior, has ransomed. now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
Yeah, it's that beautiful, amazing grace of our God that Madeline just so beautifully sang of, that I think moves me to a sense of understanding, even to know that our chains are gone, that we've been set free. Just thinking of even that story, that video that Dave showed of Greg Laurie and his son Chris passing away. I knew Chris at Biola when we were in college together, and you know, I just can't help but see something like that and think about how that person that I knew there, and he had his own struggles and his own stuff going on, and life wasn't always easy. But he knew Jesus, and he had a relationship with Jesus, and he is now in heaven. He is now in the presence of God for eternity. And I think, like, when we think about that, it just makes all this other stuff just not matter. What matters is eternity. What matters are these issues of life and death. And I want you to think about something more than what is happening in this temporary suffering that we are going through. And I want to encourage you today, if you have never placed your hope and faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, to do that now, to talk to him, to turn this off, to walk away, just say, Lord, I need you. I believe in you. Forgive me of my sin. Help me to walk with you. And may that encourage all of us today, that that is what ultimately matters most. I'd love if you have made that decision today, or if you have questions about that, just to get in touch with us. That's why we have the card. That's a way that you can just even ask us questions about what that means, or if you need help in this season, or you have doubt, or you are feeling alone, want someone to pray with you, to talk with you, to fill that card out and just ask for that. And we want to be able to be there for you in this moment with whatever it is that you're going through. And so we're grateful for you being part of this today. Thank you for worshiping with us. Encourage you this week. This is a week of Thanksgiving, to be thankful to our God for his great gift of salvation, his amazing grace that he's given us. And please join us again next Sunday morning, 9 o'clock, online and outdoors, as we express our gratitude and thanks to our Lord. So let me pray for you now as you go and as you practice Sabbath and resting in him today. Let's pray together. Lord God, we love you. Lord, we need you. And in the midst of feeling like the world is crazy and everything is kind of just, I don't know, just always changing and going so, can feel like it's going so badly, God, when we keep our eyes fixed on this world. So Lord, I pray that we keep our eyes fixed on you, that you are our rock, you are our fortress, you are our provider. Lord, you are our God. And so may we trust in you, build our faith, God. And I pray this blessing over each and every one of you, wherever you are. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may he lift his countenance to you and give you peace. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for joining us. God bless you as you go today.
May the Lord bless you and keep you.